For those of you that do not know me, my name is Stan Silverman. I'm vice chairman of the board of Drexel. And Susan asked if I would introduce her today. And of course, I said absolutely. So it's my pleasure to introduce Susan. She's a good friend and colleague. And I'm just happy to be here today, Susan, so thank you. So since October 2013, Susan has served as Senior Vice President for Online Learning at Drexel and President of Drexel University Online. In his announcement of her joining the Drexel team, President Fry stated, and I quote, "Susan brings 17 years of higher education leadership and experience and has built an international reputation as one of the premier innovators in online and distance education," unquote. Susan and her team are responsible for providing comprehensive services to the unique needs of online students. They develop and implement new approaches to delivering online curricula, as well as tracking student progress to improve retention and learning outcomes. Over 7,000 online students are served at Drexel, generating nearly $70 million per year in annual revenues. Susan is a frequent keynote speaker at national and international conferences. She is also a consultant to university presidents, government officials, and business leaders regarding strategy initiatives. She consults on international education initiatives and strategies associated with developing distance education models, as well as retention and degree completion issues. Susan served as a senior fellow at the American Association of State Colleges and Universities, where she co-authored the book, Wired for Success. She has held university executive leadership positions in some of the largest universities in the country. She is an experienced high education strategist and academic leader, having served 6 years as president of the University of Maryland University College and formerly as vice chancellor for the global campus at Troy University in Alabama. Susan is the recipient of many distinguished awards, among them the 2013 Hall of Fame Award by the U.S. Distance Learning Association, the 2011 Washington 100 Most Powerful Women Award, and the 2010 Global Award for International Technology Advancement. When I think about online education, and I think about how Drexel needs to differentiate itself among the crowded online education marketplace, there are two imperatives that I think we need to think about among others. They are these: the ability to deliver course content that keeps the professors and the students engaged, and the ability to deliver to our students a great customer experience, which in part requires an effective IT system to track their progress and provide support when it appears that they're going off track. Both of these imperatives require state-of-the-art technology and the recognition that the state-of-the-art of technology is always changing and needs to be kept up to remain competitive. In a conversation I had yesterday with Susan, she told me, "I'm not a techie." I responded with, "You don't need to be a techie. What you need to do is to set a vision in which your people can develop a sense of ownership in what they do, and then great things will happen." Ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Susan Aldridge. Susan.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to over 220 people in the auditorium and our colleagues at a distance who've joined us today. And to Stan Silverman, my sincere thanks to you for that wonderful introduction, and more importantly, for your tireless leadership at Drexel University. Thank you very much, Stan. Well, we're in for an exciting afternoon. In just a few short months, Drexel University is going to celebrate a major milestone in its history, 20 successful years as an online education provider, paving the way for thousands of students across the country and around the globe to earn a highly valuable degree by completing it entirely from a distance. And with nearly two decades of research and experience now behind us, Drexel is certainly well known for both its pioneering efforts, our entrepreneurship, and our ongoing thought leadership in technology-enhanced teaching and learning. We've come a long way since those early days when course modules were little more than a series of handouts published and delivered online. Or remember the old days of voice over PowerPoint? Gosh, it was so innovative at the time, now just terrible way to teach, and students don't learn that way. But many years ago, virtual study was, for the most part, a lonely experience for the students, predicated solely on the student's ability to passively absorb the information. But still, for many, it was an acceptable trade-off for the privilege of learning anywhere and at any time. Now, fast forward 20 years later, and we find ourselves with an amazing array of interactive technologies at our disposal. Technologies that empower us to provide our students with active, authentic, and customized learning experiences to cultivate their expert knowledge and their complex skills, because they're going to need them for their work environment and in life. The investments that we make in digital learning enhancements will always come at an opportunity cost. And that's why it's essential to understand not only why, but also how any new technology helps us provide robust and accessible learning experiences, whether they're studying online, whether they're studying on campus, or in a combination of both. So in preparing for the future, we've spent the last 6 months at Drexel University Online in research mode. We've rigorously explored some of the latest and greatest digital technologies and how they're effectively being optimized for teaching and for learning in universities and in training institutions around the world. So today, I'm delighted to be able to share just a sample of the results of our efforts in what I hope will be an exhilarating visual journey into a showcase of virtual learning possibilities as we move forward in the next 20 years of excellence, entrepreneurship, and innovation here at Drexel University. So let's begin this journey into a world of virtual reality. Put simply, virtual reality is an immersive and interactive, three-dimensional, computer-generated environment that enables us to assume virtual identities as we seamlessly move about in cyberspace, manipulating objects, and performing certain actions. Although we usually think of virtual reality as a tool for creating the imaginary worlds of entertaining video games, educators at every level are beginning to exploit its tremendous potential for teaching and for learning. To begin with, virtual reality makes it possible for students to actively learn by doing through repetitive and thought-provoking practice within a safe and multi-sensory environment. Students are able to apply new knowledge and to make mission-critical decisions while identifying objects, considering multiple perspectives, and rehearsing various responses. These virtual worlds can also be designed for both individual use as well as collaboration in a classroom, and as a digital tool for connecting students to any number of learning activities. I want to give you an example from Macquarie University in Australia. Professor Matt Bauer employs the virtual world environment called Avaya Live to create a blended and synchronous learning experience for students who study both on campus and from a distance.
And face-to-face learners in the same live experience using the Avaya Live Engage virtual world. Where students in the face-to-face classroom can see and hear remote students' avatars via a projection of the virtual world. And remote students can see and hear their face-to-face peers via a video stream into that virtual environment. We're not only able to have remote and on-campus students experience the same live teacher presentation, but also participate in group work and whole class report back activities. This enabled students in both environments to share their ideas and discuss them, almost as though they were in the same class. So ideally in the future, the technology will just become invisible, so that remote and face-to-face students develop the same sense of co-presence. Until then, blended reality, the synchronous blending of augmented reality and augmented virtuality environments, can be used to take us in that direction.
Virtual reality learning environments typically incorporate some sort of immediate feedback and reward system. And there's a reason why our sons and daughters and colleagues spend so much time on video games. This approach of virtual reality actually stimulates the release of dopamine in the brain, a powerful neurotransmitter known to increase motivation and therefore engagement, which results in better knowledge recall, retrieval, and retention over time. Virtual reality can also be customized around unique learning preferences and diverse abilities. And because it can be used for creating educational games and simulations, virtual reality has many teaching applications in just about any discipline that you can name. For instance, right here at Drexel, our College of Nursing and Health Professions faculty is using a smart avatar named Tina Jones to help online nursing students sharpen their clinical practice skills from a distance. These RNs are coming back to school for bachelor's and master's degrees. And as you will see, this 29-year-old virtual patient responds like any other real-life patient with a complicated medical history and a distinct personality. Tina has thousands of potential responses to medical assessment questions, so she offers a unique chance for students to test drive their diagnostic and interpersonal skills by performing high-stakes clinical assessments over and over if necessary. Students can conduct tests and obtain results about Tina's condition. By observing the interaction online, instructors can supply face-to-face feedback around targeted areas for improvement through video conferencing applications like Skype and Zoom. So meet Tina Jones. The students type in the questions. Hello, Ms. Jones.
Hey.
What brings you in today?
My foot is killing me. It really hurts.
How did you hurt your foot?
I was going down the back steps and I tripped. I kind of turned my ankle and scraped the bottom of my foot on the edge of the step. There's cement.
Do you have any medication allergies, the student types?
I'm pretty sure I'm allergic to penicillin.
What happens when you take penicillin?
The last time I took it, I was a kid, so I think I got a rash, like hives, and so the doctor had me stop taking them, and I never took it again.
Do you have any problems with your eyes?
I've actually been noticing problems lately. When I'm reading or studying, I'll notice that things start to get kind of blurry.
So the students can determine what tests to prescribe. So she's going to do a visual test. Please read this line.
EDFCZP.
Please cover your left eye.
Okay.
Please read this line.
EDEOXF.
Oops. Please read this line.
That one's kind of blurry.
The students can now determine what tests to run on Tina. So you can see in this environment how important it is for students to be able to try and try again and practice and how they perfect their assessment skills in this environment. The College of Nursing and Health Professions also collaborated with Drexel University Online to develop a simulation-based learning solution for online students pursuing a certificate in forensic trends and issues in contemporary healthcare. This program is designed to provide healthcare professionals with the requisite expert knowledge and practical skills to conduct comprehensive, sensitive, and legally sufficient clinical assessments in the aftermath of a violent crime. And it incorporates sophisticated simulations to ensure that students have plenty of opportunities to translate classroom skills into real-world practice. For example, a three-dimensional virtual crime scene complete with multiple clues and continuous feedback empowers the students to conduct a vulnerability risk assessment. You'll be seeing a video of the simulation that the students would be going through on their own. For our purposes today, the video is narrated by the professor, Dr. Paul Clements. The students are using virtual reality to assess a real crime scene, a real crime that occurred.
Let's go ahead and take a walk through the 3D crime scene, and this is where it all begins. So it's very important, first thing, is to get a feel for the landscape and the house and the ports of entry. Look around, get a good scope of what's going on. So if you move to the left, you'll see that there's a car in the garage with the garage door open. And when you move to the right, you'll see that there is a kitchen window. And as you look straight ahead, you will see that there is a glass storm door that you can see right through. Let's go ahead and move forward. Head up the steps. Now we're at the door. So what are some of the things we want to look at? Is there forced entry? Is the door see-through, obviously? Is the door unlocked? So let's take a look at that. Okay, so you see that a point of concern here is the door forced? Is it locked? And so this is one example that you will look at to look at for points of concern. So let's go ahead and go inside the house, and we're going to take a look around to see what we can find that could be points of interest related to the crime and how that might benefit us when we think about promoting safety for people who are in their house by themselves. So the level of detail is very exciting in the simulations. Let's go ahead and move down the hall. And here we have a security system on the right-hand side. So let's go ahead and let's take a look at the security system. So as you can see, the security system is in the standby mode. One of the things that most people don't realize is either people install security systems or they buy a house with a security system. And some people don't even know what the code is for their own security system. They're in their homes, they don't activate it, and it's really an unfortunate situation because security systems can mean the difference between assault, victimization, death. So it's very important from a safety promotion standpoint to let people know if they have a security system, they should use it. So without going on and giving away all the points of concern, let's just go through the house and you can see, for example, what's here. As we move forward down the hallway, it opens up with the bedroom on the left, and we've got the living room here straight ahead. Let's go forward into the living room. So now that you're in the living room, as we pan around, you can see where the TV, the couch, and over here behind us, you'll see the doorway to the kitchen. But let's go ahead and go all the way through to the backyard. So we've come to the door. We're going to open the door. And let's go out onto the back patio. Oops. Well, I guess what we see here now is we better be careful because there's the family dog. And it's barking at us. So we probably want to be very careful about that. Okay, let's go back into the house. So we're going to go ahead and go forward here, and we're going to move here toward the hallway again, and we're going to make our way into the bedroom. The first thing we notice is that there somehow was a lot of chaos in this room, and this is actually where the crime took place. So if we stand here and just take a quick look around, we see that there's a lamp that is tossed over, and the bed covers are all messed up. If we sort of move over here to the other side of the bed, we see that the offender accidentally forgot the duct tape that he used. So this is obviously a clue. But if you weren't paying attention and doing a good thorough assessment, this would be very easy to miss. Now if we turn and spin around and look at the bathroom, it immediately becomes clear here that this is where the initial interaction between the victim and the offender occurred. What was happening was she was showering with her front door unlocked, her phone was unplugged, her dog was in the backyard and she couldn't hear it barking, and he literally just walked into the house. And the offender was wearing gloves, a mask, and was covered from head to toe. And as you can see here, if you scroll up here, you'll see that the shower curtain is basically pulled off of its hooks. So talk about vulnerability. This was one of the most vulnerable situations. We have the act of surprise. You are in a closed space with nowhere to go except past the offender. If we pan over here to the sink, we'll see that Molly did try to get past him, and he grabbed her and pushed the back of her head into the mirror. So
in this type of a simulation, the students, if we go through the regular simulation, the students actually are locked out if they miss clues, because it can be a significant difference in terms of whether they can solve a crime or not solve a crime. And so it's important for them to not miss critical clues. There are also realistic simulations that reinforce effective strategies for interviewing victims, interviewing offenders, and to elicit details of the crime, along with a playback feature for reviewing and improving performance. Another great example of virtual reality was developed by the U.S. Army Medical Department Center and School for Recruiting and Training Patient Administrative Specialists, one of the military's many occupational specialties. It's called A Day in the Life. This virtual environment enables a prospective specialist to actually spend time in the role, becoming part of the experience by interacting with the screen rather than just clicking through a series of flat slides. So as designed, it provides an immersive, engaging, and hands-on virtual experience.
Well, hello. Welcome to the Patient Administration Division, or PAD. I am Sergeant Jensen, a Patient Administrative Specialist. I'm going to show you around so you can see what a typical day looks like around the PAD. I have a lot of work to do today, so let's get started.
Hi, I just got married and PCS'd here. I need to register my wife, Avery, and have my medical records from my last station shipped here. Can you help me?
Sure, no problem. Let's take care of your wife first. Then I can take you to the Release of Information office to request your records. Ma'am, may I please see your ID card? I need to gather some information.
The sergeant creates a new medical record, determines eligibility and family member prefix, enrolls or registers the patient in the authorized medical computer system, and initiates paperwork for record.
Thank you. Here you go, ma'am. I have also provided you with some HIPAA information.
Thank you. Can I sign out my records? I have an appointment in a few minutes.
Sorry, but according to regulations, patients are not authorized to hand carry their records. I will, however, take them to the clinic for you. Since we need to request your husband's medical records from his previous station, I will escort you to take care of both of these issues.
Okay.
The sergeant escorts the couple to the Release of Information office.
Hi, Mrs. Davis. We need to request...
So you can see what a day in the life of this particular professional would be. The Department of Defense is also using digital simulation to prepare flight mechanics in the military for maintaining the UH-60 Black Hawk helicopter. As part of a fully online training course, these simulations combine 3D graphics and animation to vividly demonstrate each part of this sophisticated machinery from multiple perspectives. Here's a quick look at the helicopter's fuel system. You can imagine if this is just-in-time education and training, these individuals can go back over and over again to look at different areas of the helicopter's system. And after watching the demonstration, it's certainly easy to see how simulation technology such as this could be used to demonstrate a step-by-step medical procedure or an engineering process. Augmented reality is a digital tool that some say is the next biggest thing in teaching and in learning. Basically, it merges virtual reality with actual reality by using computer-generated imagery through such sensory mechanisms as sound, video, and graphics to superimpose three-dimensional virtual objects over either a 3D environment or a 2D surface. So in essence, augmented reality enhances the user's perception and their interaction with the real world by overlaying additional information that is not directly perceived. We can then access these enhancements through a variety of applications and input devices, from tablets or smartphones to headsets and eyeglasses. One of the augmented reality's very first commercial applications was the now famous yellow first down line that's used in television football games. Likewise, over the past decade, it's become one of the hottest trends in visual advertising by creating hype and increasing consumer engagement with a variety of brands such as Toyota and Disney. TV weather reporters have employed augmented reality early on for weather visualizations, overlaying animated storm fronts and other changing weather conditions on a stationary green screen located behind them on the set. And today's augmented reality has transformed the weathercast by offering a variety of storytelling formats, as you will see in the following really cool YouTube video produced by the Weather Channel.
So let's talk about the anatomy of a tornado. It starts with a supercell, a rotating thunderstorm. But on these tornadoes, there is one thing that clearly stands out, especially when we look at radar. It is called a hook echo. And that hook echo is a little appendage on the southern flank of the storm. We know that these storms aren't flat. They're in the vertical, 40, 50, 60,000 feet. So let's pull this thing up and look at it. Because when you look at this big rotating thunderstorm, and as massive as it is, look at what's going on down here. Look at that tornado. So just a small part, but the most violent part of that supercell is right there in that tornado. So let's lift the base of this and talk a little bit about tornado genesis, because a lot of the research over the past several years has gone into what actually kicks off the tornado from the supercell. Well, there's one thing that stands out. You can sometimes see this when you're in the field. It is called the rear flank downdraft. It's when the upper level winds get caught in the downdraft, they come through the backside, and if that rear flank downdraft isn't super cold, it can actually allow a tornado form, especially when you have on the eastern side of that warm, moist air. So warm, moist air, cool outflow on the back side of that. You see the rotation going on, and voila, we've got ourselves a tornado.
So if a faculty member says, how can I get all the students in my class to turn off all of their devices? If you're doing this in class, you don't need to worry about it. Research indicates that students spend four times the amount of time on assignments that contain rich multimedia experiences. A demonstration like this one would be equally useful and stimulating in a classroom as a teaching tool for both online, on-campus students, or in a hybrid format. Which is why it's not surprising to see augmented reality being innovatively deployed as a technology enhancement in a variety of different academic disciplines. For example, mechanical engineering students are mastering all important technical drawing skills by using it to turn two-dimensional views into three-dimensional shapes. In a similar vein, augmented reality is bringing the study of architecture to life. NASA and EN Reality have also teamed up to use augmented reality for conducting guided tours around the solar system. When students have access to this kind of technology, they enter them and play them over and over and over again for hours at a time. So guess what? They learn. They're exploring not only the technology, but they learn at higher rates when you have this type of engaging experience for them. And what faculty member wouldn't want this experience in their class? At Cal State University Chico, a professor in the School of Education is using Arasma, a popular augmented reality platform, in her online course for pre-service teachers to school them in one of the coolest learning technologies available. This free digital tool works on mobile devices, such as tablets and smartphones, allowing the teachers to select anything in the environment, a logo, a picture, a sign, an object, and turn it into what we call a trigger that can then be overlaid with additional 3D content. So I'll show you an example of this. An elementary teacher might create a silhouette of each student in her third grade class, which can be used as a trigger. The students then fill in copies of the silhouettes with a self-portrait, while the teacher helps them then develop a 15 to 20 second video about themselves. As a final step, the students produce yet another drawing that depicts what they perceive is going on in their heads. The teacher then uses the Erasma app to upload the silhouette trigger along with the student-produced portrait, video, and a second drawing. And here's what happens when the parents hold their smartphone or tablet over the trigger.
This is Hester's personal banner. And up comes Hester. If we had headphones, we would listen to her explain her process. So, these high school students made this logo, and they also made a 1 minute compressed time video.
Of the making of the logo.
They draw underwater.
So these pictures were all created underwater.
Exactly. She's just knocked it out of the park.
How cool is that? Holograms. Holograms are another mind-blowing technology that engage students in multidimensional learning experiences and environments that are active, authentic, and customized. Basically, a hologram is a three-dimensional, freestanding image which is created with photographic projection and viewed with the help of special headsets and other wearable devices. If each of you had a wearable device, I could have a hologram of President John Fry on the stage with me. Companies are coming up with new devices every day, like Microsoft's new HoloLens headset, to extend this powerful learning technology in novel and previously unimaginable directions. Holography can take video conferencing to a physical level by facilitating remote collaboration among students, faculty, and experts worldwide in what feels like face-to-face social presence and interaction. Holograms could also allow students to conduct science experiments that are too dangerous, expensive, or difficult to perform in real life. Likewise, this technology can support virtual field trips where students can see and here, a Tudor castle, a national park, or a museum. Or they might use it to complete a design project in three dimensions and then print it on a 3D printer. And professors at Case Western Reserve University are employing Microsoft's HoloLens headset to transform how students learn about the human body. I'm so happy to have so many participants from the medical school here with us today. These opportunities are something that in the past has always required physical labs and human cadavers. But with holography, students can now cut into a virtual cadaver to understand the intricacies of and the connections among all of the human systems. Organ and skeletal, vascular, and nervous. So here's a quick demonstration.
Today we use a combination of cadavers and medical illustrations to teach students anatomy. This is a curriculum that hasn't drastically changed in over 100 years because there simply hasn't been another way. The mixed reality of the HoloLens has the potential to revolutionize this education by bringing 3D content into the real world. Now, one of the biggest challenges for students learning anatomy is understanding the body in three dimensions and how all the different systems fit together. Using holograms, we can easily separate and focus in on individual systems. For example, we can focus in on the femur, and students can immediately see some of the types of fractures they may one day encounter in the clinic. Now, I can leverage all of these new capabilities while maintaining the important connection with my students. When we're both wearing a HoloLens, I can see what they're looking at, what they're interacting with. I can assess their progress, and they can communicate with me and each other naturally. For example, I can see if Michelle has a question in class, or whether Gwen has a question while learning remotely. Now, obviously, a cadaver doesn't move. This makes it difficult to see the way a living body actually works. HoloLens doesn't have this limitation. Systems can be animated to easily see how things function. Let's take a look at the center of the cardiovascular system, the heart. It's an amazing organ. In reality, it's about the size of your fist. With HoloLens, we can easily scale up the heart so that students see minute details. We can even see inside the heart to see the valves in action. This is a new way of seeing things, and it has the potential to help students understand the structure and physiology of the body in a way that's just not possible today. Now, what you've just seen is a vision of how HoloLens could enhance one single subject. But as an educator, it's easy for me to see that it's not just anatomy that could benefit from this technology. This could change how everyone learns. Imagine for a moment some of the other fields that could be changed. For example, chemistry and genetics. Art. Engineering. And paleontology. And the best part is, we get to help define that future together. I can't wait to see what you future holographic developers are going to do with this amazing technology. Thanks.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Michelle.
So holography is also taking game-based learning tools like Minecraft to new heights of complexity and interactivity. This extremely popular Lego-style game, if you've not seen a group of 9 or 10-year-olds playing this, it's something to behold. This is extremely popular. Players of all ages create, explore, mine, and manage resources, which is why educators around the world are adopting it as a technology enhancement for teaching science, technology, engineering, and math. And by taking full advantage of the game's many engaging challenges and interactive features, the students are also developing career-focused soft skills like complex problem-solving, collaboration, communication, and leadership. So after acquiring this game, Microsoft decided to greatly expand its potential by adding an entirely new and stimulating dimension of educational play. Using the company's HoloLens, which you recently saw, it's a headset, and they're combining it virtually with augmented reality, as shown in this video demonstration.
Today, we're using a special camera. This display technique is like putting a HoloLens right on the camera itself, allowing the entire audience to see the holograms. Now, this is a live demo with real working code. Let's show what it can do.
You can play the Minecraft you know today on HoloLens. Zach's grabbed his Xbox controller to play through a giant holographic portal into a 3D Minecraft world right on the wall. Even though I don't have a HoloLens, I'm able to play together with Zach from my Surface.
Are you going to come join my game, Lydia?
I'm in now.
I see you, jumping around.
One of the cool things about HoloLens is that it lets you display Minecraft virtually anywhere. You can get different perspectives on your Minecraft world. It's awesome to play with the controller, but can we show them something new, Sax?
Sure. Just take our experience off the wall and then put it on the table over here. Create world.
Manipulate the world using his voice and his hands. He can walk around the hologram, pan around for different viewpoints, and even look inside.
Let's follow Lydia around for a bit. Follow player. I can zoom in and out for a better perspective. Closer. All the way in. Close up. What are you up to, Lydia?
I'm hopping in a minecart.
Let's take a ride down to the village. We're going to pick a different perspective. Overview.
It's incredibly cool to have Minecraft on your table. Imagine seeing your own worlds like this. Isn't it crazy that I see Sax just standing at the table, but through the HoloLens, he can see a whole Minecraft universe at his fingertips. You can even raise the entire world and see things that are normally hidden way underneath the ground. Could you give us a sneak peek of what's under that village, Sax?
Sure. Grab the world, lift it up, and let's see what's hiding underneath Lydia. Ooh. Huge stronghold right underneath. I'm going to mark that for you.
So I can tell you're having a lot of fun with that, but I'm going to move on to video conferencing. Video conferencing is yet another way to enhance the student learning experience. From simple applications like Skype and FaceTime to cloud-based services such as Google Plus Hangouts, these digital tools pave the way for supporting real-time, face-to-face interaction from a distance with anyone, anywhere, by a number of different devices. In fact, video communication is in many ways a dream come true for students and faculty alike because it allows them to exploit the technology they love while experiencing the face-to-face camaraderie that they genuinely need and enjoy. And in teaching and learning possibilities, the teaching and learning possibilities are limited only by the imagination, especially given the minimal cost and coordination time associated with facilitating any number of innovative activities. Workforce education expert Elliot Macy from New York makes a good case for providing students with video conferencing access to real-world experts like individuals who work in labs, individuals who are interested in contributing to course discussions, facilitating group projects, and this is a concept that's catching on quickly at Florida International University's Chaplain School of Hospitality and Tourism Management. The professors there are taking full advantage of sophisticated video conferencing in the school's five-star restaurant management lab to dish up collaborative training. By mounting large screens in key locations around the lab, they're connecting students around the country to learn at the hands of expert chefs from anywhere in the world. So here's a look at how they're doing it.
The onset was to have a single display monitor over the bar area. The faculty and chef instructors use that display as their focal point for when they're giving lectures. Not the cooking or kitchen equipment, not the architecture behind the actual facility. It is that display that's above the bar.
And what could be more amazing than taking environmental science students on an interactive tour of the Great Barrier Reef in Australia without ever leaving home? Well, that's exactly what the Reef Aquarium is hosting with the use of sophisticated video conferencing technology, complete with true-to-life, high-definition sound and videos. Here's an example of what students might see thanks to the collaborative efforts of divers and marine biologists there. These divers are communicating in real time with students.
At Reef HQ Aquarium, we believe that learning is a lifelong process. Through the provision of experiential educational initiatives, such as our Reef Video Conferencing Program, Reef HQ Aquarium ensures students of all ages have a clear understanding of the value of the Great Barrier Reef, the threats to its sustainable future, and their role in protecting it. Our Reef Video Conferencing Program is recognized as an example of global best practice in the use of video-based outreach education.
Although video conferencing offers a number of ways to create connected learning experiences for students and faculty and outside experts, robotic telepresence enables us to further personalize the interaction. This personalization is particularly important from a social or a collaborative learning perspective with respect to closing what we distance educators refer to as the transactional or physical distance among and between online students and their instructors. While the majority of online education is asynchronous or self-paced, a growing number of online instructors see the added value in connecting distance learners with their on-campus counterparts for synchronous group discussions, projects, and other experiential activities. And the use of independently mobile robots, like the Kubi robot, allows for a video conferencing experience that is far more flexible and seamless, immersive, interactive, and truly personalized, such as what you will now see in a graduate education course at Michigan State University. And the Kubi is right here on the desk, so you can check it out at the end.
Classes. Traditional video conferencing technologies are commonly used.
When you are using video conferencing, it's very common to see all these different faces on the screen if you're here in the classroom and not really know where to look. It creates this distance between the speaker who's online and the speakers in the class.
What if we could put online students in the classroom, in a robot? How would their presence change? Innovative video conference technologies and the experience of the design studio bring telepresence to EPET's Pro Seminar for first-year students.
So this semester we decided to try to break down their transactional distance to see if it was easier to connect with an online student through their Kubi robot in their head screen. You could look right there at the student or turn and look at the student to see if it was easier for those of us in the class to connect with those students online.
At first, it really had some challenges.
As the only face-to-face student, Sarah Greter has perspective beyond the technology.
The class is hybrid, and some of the hybrid students already knew each other, and I didn't, so kind of this distance between us because I didn't know them, and the technology made it, you know, added on to that distance. But as the course evolved and we got to know each other, got to use the technology, we positioned the robots into a semicircle, and that transition really helped. It looked more like a natural environment for a classroom, and it made me feel more integrated into the class, and that was very helpful.
I also want to see if it's easier for online students to connect with those in the classroom.
They can actually turn their head screen. They can move around and listen to someone. But then you have all of these challenges with how to make online students feel engaged, feel a part of the class when their colleagues are physically here.
It takes more brain power to control a robot than it does to just pop onto Zoom and see everyone's faces. There's a lot of things that you're paying attention to.
As far as feeling like I am there, the technology, you can definitely feel that the technology is there. It does go away after you feel like you're comfortable with it, and you feel like you can actually talk to other people there. Part of it may be because we're familiar with each other.
Because I know everyone in the class, or most everyone in the class, I've met them before. That's just one less thing I have to worry about in a way. Like, our relationships are there. And I think when I'm in robot form, I feel more of a presence in the physical space of the classroom, almost like I'm there.
The robot technology itself isn't perfect. It's still new, but the potential to transform classroom interactions is there.
The challenge for me is that I can't see most of the other students' faces because there's so many of us that are virtual participants. So what I see are little robots around the room, and then thank goodness there's people interspersed between those robots.
Well, it's all around, so it is definitely an integral part of the class. It's there. But when you're in the discussion and it's lively, then you kind of forget the technology around you.
The biggest thing has been being willing to try out this unfamiliar territory, knowing that there are going to be technical difficulties along the way. Are people able to hear each other? Is there too much sound? The online students have to figure out how to move their head screen to actually look at someone. The mobile robot has to figure out how to move around the room.
Being able to move around definitely adds another layer of my presence. I mean, you have to be conscious of it while you're doing it, so you're not running into things, and you can kind of rock back and forth. But the thing I like about it is that you can sit where you would like to, similar to a face-to-face classroom.
And using the robots really felt like it was the environment was physically closer to having everybody in the same room at the same time.
When done.
So think about these robots. So in the Learning Technologies group here at Drexel University Online, Corey Schmidt, Obina Adi, and the team have tested some of these devices, and so they might have some interesting perspectives for you as well. In serving online students, it's also a challenge to provide them with experiences that would normally require an on-site or a physical presence, as is the case for online nursing students who need to master certain clinical competencies. So at Duke University's School of Nursing, they're deploying telepresence robots as an instructional tool for advanced practice nursing students to engage them from a distance in high-fidelity, lifelike clinical simulations. As telemedicine becomes more prevalent and taught in nursing schools and in medical schools, it's important for students to be fully proficient in the process, which is where robots for simulation empower them to practice providing high-quality healthcare services without losing the in-person patient connection. And as an aside note, Duke University won the 2015 Bayada Award for Technological Innovation in Healthcare Education, and an honor that Drexel's College of Nursing and Health Professions was proud to facilitate under the leadership of Dean Gloria Donnelly. So let's look at what they're doing at Duke.
As educators, we're always looking for innovative ways to use technology, and I think the use of the robot has certainly met our need.
We have been using the double robots as an educational tool to engage our nursing students with our advanced practice students.
Actually, using the double has been kind of fun. We were looking for a way to incorporate our nurse practitioner students into simulation.
We do a couple different types of simulations. We do some with what we call serenized patients, which are paid live actors that act as patients. And then we also do some with what we call high fidelity simulators. So these are computerized mannequins that they blink, and get heart sounds, lung sounds. They also hook up to a monitor, so the students get sort of an experience that would be similar to what they would see in a hospital.
In the past, the nurse practitioner students would come and join the pre-licensure students, the ABSNs, in simulation. And the nurse practitioner who would be in the building, maybe in class, would be told to come, you know, and help the students out. When they became distance-based, they were no longer here to do that.
Once the advanced practice program changed to distance-based, we were faced with the challenge of how can we still keep our nurse practitioner students involved in the simulations with our pre-licensure students. So the robot actually became a great way, a great tool, if you will, to have a presence of the nurse practitioners here on campus.
Having a nurse practitioner presence in simulation is just very beneficial for the students. It provides teamwork opportunities, certainly communication opportunities for the students, and it goes both ways. The ABSNs are communicating with the advanced practice nurses, the nurse practitioners, and in return, the nurse practitioner students need to learn how to get the information from the ABSN students.
The telepresence robots allow a end user, such as our students, to have more autonomy over their interaction and engagement in a clinical simulation. By our students having autonomy to actually drive, they feel like they are more part of our community here.
We like the idea that our students are seeing emerging technologies as well, because in healthcare they'll likely see the use of that type of technology, so we're starting that while they're students. They're all 21st century learners, so they love the infusion of innovative technology.
As healthcare evolves to integrate telehealth into standard clinical practice, our educational offerings also have to evolve to meet those needs. So here at the Duke University School of Nursing, we are integrating telehealth technology into our educational offerings so that as our students graduate, they are comfortable using this 21st century technology.
It really does add a presence to the simulation.
So you can imagine Dr. Mark Greenberg is here. He could put an iPad on the top of one of these robots and have the robot roll into one of his classes. You can have a double of yourself on site, so you can control the mobile base, so you can attend meetings. How cool is that? Last, but certainly not least, wearable technology is yet another digital tool that is quickly taking root in the world of higher education. Indeed, the new age of wearables is actually tap into the connected self. And by that, I mean they integrate smart sensors with a wireless web connection, typically Bluetooth, to assist you in achieving any number of goals, like losing weight or keeping fit. The most commonly known devices can also be deployed in the classroom as an aid for organizing time or for helping students self-regulate their learning process. In fact, educational psychologists are piloting the use of Apple Watches to track how, where, and whom students are studying, data that's going to be used by faculty to improve the learning experience for their students. Likewise, wearables make it possible for students and their instructors to serve up the digital world hands-free. And to be sure, this hands-free concept is making its way into tech-savvy universities around the world. Let me show you the Mayo, which advances PowerPoint slides. You have it on your arm and it automatically advances the PowerPoint slides. The Florida International University's Chaplain School of Hospitality uses this Mayo to advance slides in the classroom for faculty members when they don't want to have them touching the devices because it's not sanitary for the students. So you can see a couple of these later and see how they work. These hand-free devices allow presenters to use arm gestures for manipulating and supplementing content displayed on the video screen. In our own university, as you have just seen here, the highly entrepreneurial Shima Seiki Hote Technology Lab is actively exploring the realm of possibilities for creating smart garments. These smart garments are clothing items that are used from hats to shirts to shoes made of fabrics that are embedded with technology. And its potential utility is nothing short of amazing, particularly when it comes to medical, military, and physical fitness. Now that we're nearing the end of the journey today, I think it most appropriate to conclude by saying that the future of connected learning is well within our power to invent and utilize here at Drexel University. Learning that puts technology creatively to work in designing the education that is active, authentic, and customized, while linking our university community across time and space to the enormous world of possibility beyond our campus. This is what some will believe will be the connected classroom of the future, using the technologies and the digital tools and applications that you have seen today. And while this represents a physical space, the technologies it exploits can be used by students in virtual as well as classroom learning environments. thank you for joining me in this infinite world of possibilities for teaching and learning. Thank you very much. Please join me in thanking Stan Silverman and a host of individuals who have helped prepare this event and make it possible. I sincerely thank you all. We have a few minutes left for questions that you might have, and I know that people who are at a distance, we have a couple hundred people who are also at a distance that may be sending in questions for us that I'm happy to try to answer for you. We have a couple of events that are coming up that I want to make sure that you put on your calendar. We're celebrating National Distance Learning Week here at the university, so please join us for these upcoming events. We can send you additional information about that as well. So let me open it up for questions that you might have today. Yes. It's really important in order for students to learn to have at least some engaging exercises and opportunities in each of the classes. So it's how they learn. The old days of read-only, chat-only, or just talking head videos are not sufficiently engaging for the students, and so they're not going to stay engaged through the course, and sometimes they drop the course. So with lots of free apps, and Robbie Melton's session will be coming up, Robbie and her team have reviewed over 70,000 mobile apps just for education. Many of them are free, so they've been reviewed and they by the subject area as well as by the level of education for K-12, for higher education, master's degree, and so on. So through our relationship with Robbie, for free, you can go into this website, you can check and look at what your colleagues have said about these various applications, and you can download them and utilize them in your class or have your students utilize them as supplementary materials. So in working with the course designers, whether it's Corey and his team, Ellen Hecht is here, other course designers across the university, there are a lot of free applications that are available. There are a lot of free or low-cost opportunities in OpenCourseWare through Merlot. So it's a matter of thinking about what you would like to do in your class that would be best for the students. You don't want to have it so busy that the students are not focusing on the content. But at the same time, it's really critical for us to have access to additional applications. So if you touch base with Corey and his team, with Alan and his team, we've got some excellent course designers across the university. I know Ian is working with you in the Close School. We create these opportunities to just blow your mind with dazzling opportunities and say, don't not use these because you don't know that they're available. Please talk to us about what's available because they're really tremendous opportunities. And some of them are not that expensive. Now, the HoloLens from Microsoft, $3,000 available in the spring, but the cost will come down over time. Even if you have three or four of them for a classroom, it's a significant difference in terms of the quality of the education that they receive. So thank you, very good question. Other questions? Questions from people at a distance, Corey? Oh, there's a question over here. Yes, I think if you can stand up, we can hear you. Not by the individual technologies here, because this mic keeps going in and out of me. But there have been studies that have done on some of the previous versions of technology. And so one of the things that the vendors for this technology want to know is what's the impact on learning, which is why they have grants that are available. Microsoft, for example, right now, or this summer, issued RFPs for 5 different universities at $100,000 apiece to test this software to see how faculty are using it in the classroom and how students are learning. So I think over time we will see more and more research that's done by faculty about the learning process. Because at the end of the day, it's not about the bells and whistles. Some of these things are incredibly cool. but it's really about how students are learning and how faculty are teaching. So we're looking forward to team up with faculty to help us demonstrate how students are learning as well. So thank you so much for that question. Other questions? I'm sorry, I can't see you. Yes. Oh, go ahead, in the back.
So there was a lot of nice things that you showed up there, and there's a lot of different implementations based on subject matters and things like that. What kind of goals do the university have in representing or in implementing those where strategically relevant for different disciplines?
So we have innovation. We have what I call pockets of genius and innovation across this university. And I think one of the most difficult challenges that we have is to learn what's going on in all the various colleges. We have faculty in the College of Education that have demoed some of the robotics, not the Kubi, but another one that our team thinks is even better, that Corey and his team thinks is even better maybe than the Kubi that's used in Michigan. I think at the end of the day, teaming faculty members who are interested in taking advantage of this technology-enhanced space because our students live and exist in this space, working with course designers and working with all of us to really think about what's possible. What do you want to teach and what might be out there that could be an enhancement to your face-to-face course, to your hybrid course, as well as online? Collaborating together to build new opportunities. The simulation of Dr. Paul Clements and the crime scene was built for his class. We have other types of technology that was actually built for a class. Carl Akimoto in our law school worked on OpryNet, which helps create opportunities for law students to upload short, they get an assignment, they upload short video clips of their response to a client in a law firm. They evaluate each other in the class, and then the faculty member evaluates them, but an outside expert who is an attorney who specializes in that field takes their iPad, uploads a short video clip of what they would do in this situation. It ratchets up the entire quality of the experience for the students. And second of all, when the students know that their video clip that they upload from their iPad, which is low tech these days, when they upload that short 2 to 3 minute video clip and they know that a national attorney specializing in this field is going to be seeing it, it's a mini job interview for them. So we can use a combination of low tech and high tech. Some of these things are free. Some of the robots are pretty expensive. The Kubi is $599. So you can have a whole group of those in sitting on a conference room desk. But it's about taking a risk to explore what's possible and thinking about what's out there that may be free and accessible to you in your class and in your subject matter. And that's what we want the opportunity to explore with all of you going forward. So we're genuinely excited about the opportunities at Drexel. There have been interactive software that's been developed in the medical school by faculty members, in the College of Nursing, and across the campus. So just the opportunity to sit down and explore will be helpful. The collaboratory is a place to do that. The collaboratory was an ingenious idea of Corey Schmidt and his team to pull together faculty and staff and individuals who have developed applications, developed new ideas, and to create an environment where they can share that with faculty from around the university. It's fantastic. Anyone that hears about this idea wants to be there. It may be in the middle of the day, so I don't know if there are adult beverages at this event, but you can at least have a cup of coffee and explore the opportunities with your colleagues. I think they stay longer when they're adult beverages, but it's still fun. Let's take one more question, and then we'll break for the reception. Question, Corey?
So a number of the online questions are in reference to how does the university plan on providing infrastructure in order to develop these technologies and working with faculty? There were at least three questions online about that.
Oh, terrific. Well, we're doing a number of things already. First, the course designers from the various colleges are getting together to meet as a group to share ideas, share some of their work. We're doing a much better job of taking software and simulations and take OperaNet from the College of Law, for example. That was repurposed and is now being used in the College of Nursing and Health Professions. We're taking a look at some of the technology that's been developed by Chris Detweiler in the College of Medicine to see whether or not some of that software can be repurposed into other colleges across the university. So the collaboratory becomes a way for us to see what's happening so we can think about how to not only talk about it in our speeches, talk about it in our blogs and our writing that we're doing so we can promote the great work that all of you are doing, but at the same time, to really think about how to repurpose it. I mean, it's really terrific to see, you know, the divers at the Great Barrier Reef, but at the end of the day, it's really the thought process around how can we utilize that type of technology? How can we bring these divers into our classrooms, for example? What does it cost? Not all of it is prohibitively expensive. If we can have four or five Kubis in a classroom, for example, honestly, we probably spend that on lunches that we have in our colleges and our operations each year. What a better way to invest in trying something new for the faculty. We need to give the faculty a no-risk, low-risk environment to just get excited about what's possible and to really explore those avenues because they're so busy. They're so busy in the classroom and with their research, they don't have time. So we're trying to create opportunities like today, like the session with Robbie Melton. She comes with two giant suitcases full of mobile apps. She calls herself an app ologist. She's a bigger than life personality, and she and her team have literally researched and evaluated from an IT perspective as well as a faculty perspective over 70,000 different mobile apps for their applicability to the education environment. So all of you, because you work here with us, have an opportunity to go into that website for free and to check out apps that are available, many for free. Some of them are low cost, but you'll see some of the possibilities of what's available. Our commitment at Drexel University Online is to work with the course designers to provide them with the support that they need, work with the faculty to explore what's possible, to help bring this kind of technology enhancement to your classroom, because the really rich, robust, engaging classes, if the students spend four times the amount of time in a multimedia environment, they're learning. And that's what we're here for. So if we can help you explore those opportunities, connect you to other colleagues around the country, collaborate with designing new simulations, help you write grants, support you with the grants that you have, that's what we're here for, and that's what we want to do in the future. Thank you very much for coming. I'm going to leave my email address here for you in case any of you want to contact me directly. Some of my business cards are out in front. We have a really talented team of people who are here that can help you answer questions. And if you've got ideas in your college that you're exploring, please share them so we can promote what you're doing around the country and around the world as we do these speeches and as we write blogs, as we tweet out information. We want the world to understand what a special place Drexel University is. Thank you very much, everyone.